Welcome and thank you for joining us at Messiah Online for worship today. Whether we are in person in our worship center here in Yorba Linda, California, or you're watching this from your living room in North Orange County near our church, or in Texas or New Jersey or England or Uganda, we are worshiping God together today. Worship always focuses on God at the center, and it grounds our faith community in the biblical and continuous account of God in Christ. Worship is always an invitation for us to be active participants in God's ongoing story. Worship is one of the ways that we get to respond to God's presence, to God's love, and to God's movement in our lives and our world. So thank you for joining us and participating with us in this worship. Please make sure that you take a moment to let us know that you're worshiping with us today. Simply scroll down on the Worship Now page to the six icons there at the bottom and click on the Check In Now icon. Also, if you have any prayer requests or you want to see a list of folks that you can pray for, you can click on the appropriate icon and it will direct you to what you are looking for. We're excited to announce the beginning of a brand new four-week Bible study on prayer led by Pastor Jay. This study is going to be on campus on Wednesdays beginning on August 11th. There's a 4 p.m. and a 7 p.m. class, and you can sign up for that class online. And now let's begin our worship together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Peace throughout the world, for the unity.
In the Bible, the word forgiveness often means sending away or letting go. And these phrases conjure up the image of releasing a caged animal back into the wild. Or imagine releasing a dove to freedom. It will fly away from your hands, high into the sky, never to return. Holding on to anger or hurt we feel about our past is like living with a wild animal, a wild squirrel in our house. Slowly destroys our house from the inside out, but maybe the squirrel has been living in our house for so long that we're not sure what our life would be without it. Forgiveness, which we're going to be talking about today, Pastor Jay is going to be unpacking a parable about an unforgiving servant. Forgiveness is not forgetting what has happened to us. Instead, it's simply letting the wild squirrel living in our house go free. Forgiveness is making the choice to stop carrying the weight of our past anger, hurts, and disappointments, those brought on by ourselves as well as others. It's giving up our right to get even with those who've hurt us. Forgiveness is making the choice to move forward, not allowing our past to hold us hostage anymore. Forgiveness is an act of mercy towards someone who's hurt us, someone who may not deserve our mercy, but we give it anyway. It's a gift to our offender, and it's a gift to ourselves. And so we pray, Dear Lord, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And all God's children say, Amen. The good news for today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 18th chapter, verses 21 through 33. And it is the story of the parable of the unmerciful servant. And then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times? And Jesus answered, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And as he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he wasn't able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had to be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged, and I'll pay back everything. Well, the servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. And his fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, be patient with me and I'll pay it back. But he refused. And instead he went off and he had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged, and they went and told their master everything that had happened. And then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said, I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? The Gospel of our Lord.
Imagine that you owed someone $9 billion, with a B, $9 billion. That's one Bible scholar's estimate of how much, in today's American dollars, this servant owed the king in this story. If you have a Bible with notes, those notes may give a different estimate. The more recent the Bible, the higher the number will be. It's clearly a lot of money. Millions or billions. Billions with a B. More money than most of us could ever pay back. This chapter, chapter 18 of the Good News according to Matthew, began with the disciples asking a question about the kingdom of heaven, what Mark and Luke call the kingdom of God, or God's values being lived out in the world. And what follows includes a series of discussions about children, in which Jesus says that we are to enter the kingdom by becoming like little children, not by becoming educated Bible scholars or wise, experienced business people, for example. And a discussion also follows about how to live in community with other people who are followers of Jesus. And it might be that discussion about community that prompts Peter's question about how many times he should forgive another Jesus follower who sins against him. And after giving an answer that sounds like a math quiz, was it 77 times or was it 70 times 7 times? Either way, it would be really hard to keep track of how many times you'd forgiven someone. Jesus tells a story about a king forgiving a debt, forgiving a lot of debt, millions or billions of dollars. We're focusing in this series on parables, sayings and stories told by Jesus, sayings and stories that have a point and that don't go the way that Jesus' initial audience would have expected them to go. Jesus' parables, stories, sayings have a twist to them. It's grasping the twist that makes the story meaningful. The parables also referred to some tangible, real-world physical thing or some real-world experience or example that Jesus' initial followers would be familiar with and would relate to. In this story, the tangible, real-world thing is debt. Sound familiar? Debt was a huge problem in first century Palestine. When the Jews rebelled against the Roman Empire in 66 AD, the first thing the rebels did was burn down the treasury building where the financial records were kept. This would be the equivalent of hacking into and crashing a bank's central computer system, or maybe not just shutting down an oil pipeline by hacking the company's billing system, but actually wiping out all of the company's records of accounts payable, making it impossible for them to collect the money that was owed them. Jesus' story begins with a king who rules, as we would expect and assume, by the rules. Jesus' listeners would assume that, like a banker, this king, who was probably a Gentile tyrant, will collect what is owed to him. It's not about what the servant did wrong to get so hopelessly in debt, or whether he and his master are on good terms. It's simply that the king expects to collect what is owed to him. And the servant must have a long and generally positive relationship with this king to have been trusted with enough to rack up this kind of debt. This servant is tough. Maybe he's even ruthless because he's had to negotiate the halls of power. People who act primarily out of kindness didn't last long in the palace. And yet this tough, powerful servant finds himself having to beg for extra time, to ask the king to be kind-hearted. He has to beg for mercy, throw himself at the king's feet. Jesus' initial audience must have broken out into laughter at the thought of his begging, followed by his ridiculous promise. "I'll pay you back billions," he said. "Just give me more time." Jesus has set up an impossible scenario. There is no way he's going to pay the king back. And depending on the king, he could pay for his life, pay with his life for breaking this promise. And that's where we get the first twist. The servant's master, the king, canceled the debt and let him go. Is the king naive? Does he fall for the servant's promise? No, not really. He does more than that. He cancels the debt marks it paid in the book. He writes paid in full and hands the servant the canceled promissory note. The king depletes his own wealth to save the servant from certain poverty and suffering. But then this servant, who's just been forgiven billions of dollars in debt, goes out and finds another servant who owes him a much smaller sum, maybe something between $12,000 and $40,000, grabs this other servant by the scruff of the neck, hauls him off to beggar's prison. The parable is so far-fetched that Jesus' audience must have smiled or even laughed out loud until they realized that the first servant's greed and self-centeredness represented their own. Do you realize how soon that first servant forgot the huge debt that had been forgiven him by the king? It was as if he somehow believed he was worthy of forgiveness when he had simply lucked into owing this huge debt to someone who didn't need to be paid back, when he had experienced unmerited grace, mercy, and forgiveness. But then he went on to act like that strict bookkeeper he had expected the king to be. Rather than following in the king's footsteps, he yielded to his own greed. Right after experiencing grace and forgiveness, he flipped and aggressively sought out someone who owed him a much smaller sum of money. Now, maybe he had only known ruthless behavior all of his life up until now, and he didn't know how to do anything but be ruthless. Maybe this idea was so new to him that he didn't know how to respond. Maybe he was unable to absorb the meaning of being forgiven, at least in a way that allowed him to change how he acted toward his fellow servants. He wasn't changed. He wasn't transformed. The skills that had served him well up to this point now led to his downfall. And in failing to be transformed, failing to grasp the opportunity for new life, he actually was choosing the way of death and failure. Jesus ends the story this way. In verse 34, he says, "In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed." Then Jesus went on in verse 35, "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart." Now, we shouldn't assume that this meant the man was going to hell. The people of first century Israel were mostly physicalists. Their focus wasn't on an afterlife. They were waiting for God to act decisively in earthly human history. And they would have heard this ending as meaning that if you learn to forgive others, when God acts decisively in earthly human history, things are going to go well for you. But if you don't learn to forgive others, if your heart isn't changed, things will go badly for you. So the second twist in this story is that experiencing grace, mercy, and forgiveness is intended to bring about change. It shouldn't just benefit you. It should change your life in a way that also benefits people around you. If you're full of God's love, if you've experienced God's love in a way that is just overflowing, God's love will come pouring out of you onto other people. God's love and forgiveness will change your heart. Now, it's true that Jesus called people to keep the law as he reinterpreted it in, for example, the Sermon on the Mount and in his other teachings. It's easy for us American Christians today to miss the point, to miss how Jesus' teachings are more about how to live in the kingdom, how to live by God's values in this life, than they are about getting into heaven in the next. And this story illustrates how experiencing God's love, mercy, and forgiveness can, but might not, motivate us and teach us to live lives of love, mercy, and forgiveness, to live by God's values. When we realize how much we've been forgiven, we're called to respond by loving Jesus and by loving the people he loves, loving our neighbors as ourselves, and extending them the grace and forgiveness we experience because of Jesus Christ. As Jesus says of the sinful woman in Luke chapter 7, she loved much because she had been forgiven much. When we've experienced grace and mercy, we can learn to be gracious and merciful. My father was a businessman. I suppose now we'd say business person in rural Iowa. In addition to owning an independent insurance brokerage, he always had some kind of what we would now call a side hustle. Before people stopped buying fur coats, he raised chinchillas. He ran a small property management company. And for a while, he had a loan company. At one point, there was another local business person who owed him some money which he could not pay back. It wasn't millions or billions, but it was a significant amount. It was enough that if my dad had just invested that money in the stock market and let it ride, I could live differently today. Now, my dad held a secured loan. He could have collected the money by forcing this man into bankruptcy and making him sell off his assets, which is probably what I would have done. But my dad knew that this same man also owed money to a lot of my dad's friends and neighbors. And if my dad got repaid, his friends wouldn't. So my dad walked over to the bank and signed paperwork forgiving the loan. To my knowledge, no one else ever knew what my dad had done, and this man remained a successful, respected business person in this community the rest of his life. Like the king in this story, my dad forgave a loan. He extended mercy and grace to a man who could not have repaid him, except at the cost of losing his business and his livelihood, and at the cost of damaging the entire community where they lived. When we say that we are called to live lives based on God's grace, love, and mercy, I think of what my dad did, not just for that one other man, but for many other people in this small community, many other people who probably never knew what it was that my dad did. The sinful woman I mentioned from Luke chapter 7 loved Jesus very much because she knew she had been forgiven much. We are called both to live by God's law as it is reinterpreted by Jesus, and we are called to be animated, by mercy, love, and forgiveness. We sometimes forget that Jesus' ministry included tax collectors and sinners, people considered the dregs of the earth, perhaps unredeemable by the respected element, including the religious leaders of first century Judaism. As we are forgiven much, we are called to forgive others, living lives of mercy, love, and forgiveness, loving our neighbors, even those our society might consider unlovable, as Jesus loves us. We are called to respond to God's love and forgiveness with changed hearts, so that love, mercy, and forgiveness toward others is at the heart of what it means for us to follow Jesus and what it means to be children of God. Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us so much that we are forgiven. We are forgiven so that we can be in relationship with you. Inspired by the love of Jesus for us and for all the world, including our neighbors, inspire us to love our neighbors. Change our hearts so that we can love others as you love us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's join together now in confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
This is Nueva Vida. Nueva Vida, meaning new life, was founded in 1998 after Hurricane Mitch devastated some communities surrounding Lake Managua. The displaced were sent here to rebuild in refugee communities, and many of those same families still call this home, most struggling to make ends meet on a daily basis. Thanks to groups like yours, Rise Against Hunger works in communities like this all around the world. Here in Nicaragua, our in-country distribution partner, Orphan Network, distributes those meals that volunteers package. And coupled with education, further tutoring, and vocational training, these meals bring hope and a future. Your support changes lives. Thank you for your commitment to ending hunger. This is possible because of what we get to do together.
Each week we take a moment to have what we call a love moment. And we just saw this beautiful video about Rise Against Hunger and how this ministry and this opportunity will provide food for thousands and thousands of children throughout our world. As we mark the passage of 2 decades since 9/11, the day that changed our lives forever, we're going to join together in service to honor the lives that were lost and to honor all the heroes who responded in this deep hour of need. This day has been set aside nationally as a day not to focus on hate or revenge, but on the power of love and service to others. As lovers and followers of Jesus, we want to join with others and bring the light of Christ's love to the world. We want to join together to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, to visit the lonely. Our goal is to not only be a part of recapturing the spirit of unity and compassion that inspired our nation following the attacks, but to rededicate ourselves to loving God and loving one another in our community, in our world. We hope that you're going to join us on Saturday, 9/11, for a day of both service and commemoration. We're joining together to raise at least $7,000 for Rise Against Hunger. We're over halfway to our goal. That $7,000 will help us provide 20,000 meals for children who are facing severe hunger in our world. Our day here at Messiah is going to start at 2 p.m. as we come together to package those 20,000 meals. It's going to be followed by a picnic that begins at 4:30 with food trucks serving up American favorites of hot dogs and hamburgers. And then at 6 p.m., we're going to have a free concert, an outdoor concert on our north lawn with the theme Love Wins. Now, you can contribute to our Rise Against Hunger goal by going online to our Give Now icon and then just scroll down in the box marked Giving Type to Rise Against Hunger. You could also mail in a check to Messiah and just designate a Rise Against Hunger or 9/11 on it. If you'd like to participate in the meal packing, sign up online for that by going to our homepage and clicking on Rise Against Hunger and just follow the prompts. And everybody who helps package our meals is going to get a ticket for a free meal at the picnic. So please join us for this great event. As we move now into our offering time, we want to remind you of the various ways that you can continue to support the ministry here at Messiah. You can give online. You can give automated through your bank. You can mail in your gifts, or you can drop them off here at Messiah Lutheran on Monday mornings during our Caring Hands food pantry drop-off at 9 in the morning to 11. I want to thank you once again for all of your continued support, all the ways that you continue to make it possible through your generosity for us to impact this world with the very real, living, and tangible love of Jesus. Now, please join me in a word of prayer. Gracious God, thank you for the gift of forgiveness. Jesus, you loved me enough to come to earth and experience the worst pain imaginable so I could be forgiven. Your mercy flows to me in spite of my faults and failures and all of my mess-ups. Your word tells us to clothe ourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. Help me demonstrate that unconditional love, even to those who have hurt me. Sometimes I'm afraid to do this, Lord. My emotions and my ego don't have to control my actions. God, let your words of goodness and grace saturate my mind, my body, and my soul. And through your Holy Spirit, direct my thoughts. Help me release the hurt and begin to love as you have first and always loved me. I want to see those who have hurt, angered, betrayed, or disappointed me through your eyes. If I can be forgiven, so can they. I understand there are no levels to your love for all your children. And your desire is that we should all know the comfort and peace of your love and your forgiveness. May others come to know that through me. You teach us to let the peace that comes from Christ rule in our hearts. When I forgive in words, allow your Holy Spirit to fill my heart with peace. I pray that this peace that only comes from you will rule in my heart. Help me to live filled with gratitude for this forgiveness, not just today, not just this week, but always. With gratitude, Lord, we draw closer to you and we can let go of our unforgiveness. With gratitude, we can see the person who caused us pain as your child, a child of the King of the universe, loved and accepted. Help me find the compassion that comes with true forgiveness. We pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's children say, Amen. And now let us join together in praying the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Forgive our sins as we forgive. You taught us, Lord, to us grace to live the words we say. How can your pardon reach and bless the unforgiving heart that broods on wrongs and will not let old bitterness
Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace, love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.